Good morning and welcome to the Justice Committee's eighth meeting of 2017. We have apologies from Liam MacArthur and Oliver Mundell. Agenda item number one is the decision on whether to take item five in private. Our members agreed to take item five, which is a discussion on our work programme, in private. Thank you. Agenda item number two is the Justice Subcommittee on Policing and its feedback from the convener of the Justice Subcommittee on its meeting of 23rd of February 2017. Following the verbal report from Mary, there will be an opportunity for brief comments and questions if there are any specific areas of work that members wish the Justice Committee to consider in more detail. This can be discussed under the work programme agenda item at the end of today's meeting. I refer members to paper one and ask Mary to provide the feedback.
Thank you, Convener. The Justice Subcommittee on Policing met on the 23rd of February 2017 when it took evidence from Derek Penman, Her Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary in Scotland, on the update report on police call handling. The subcommittee heard about the significant progress that has been made by Police Scotland since the first report on call handling was published by HMICS towards the end of 2015. And call handling is an issue which the subcommittee plans to return to at a later date, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Do members have any questions for Mary? Right, no questions. Therefore, we shall move on to the next item, which is agenda item number three, limitation, childhood abuse, Scotland Bill, witnesses' expenses. Ask members to delegate responsibility to me for arranging for the SPCB to pay under Rule 12.4.3 any expenses of witnesses who provided evidence on the limitation of childhood abuse Scotland Bill. Are we agreed?
Great.
Right. Agenda item number four. Our next item of business is our first session of evidence taking on the Railway Policing Scotland Bill, and I refer members to paper two, which is a note by the clerk, and paper three, which is a spice briefing paper. I also welcome today's witnesses, starting with Charlotte Vitty, Interim Chief Executive of British Transport Police Authority, Chief Constable Paul Crowther, British Transport Police UK, Assistant Chief Constable Bernard Higgins, Operations and Justice Police Scotland, and finally, but last but not least, John Foley, who is Chief Executive of Scottish Police Authority. So can I thank the panellists very much for their written submissions and go straight to questions. Douglas Ross, Stuart Stevenson.
First of all, start with Mr. Foley and ask how important an issue the Scottish Police Authority believes the integration of BTP in Police Scotland is.
Yes, Mr. Ross, it's a very important issue for us. We have been engaging and participating with colleagues since the outset.
And participation. Can I ask why you didn't respond to the call for evidence to this committee?
We felt that it was more appropriate to give oral evidence to the committee.
Is that standard practice for the SPA not to submit written evidence to read prior to the oral evidence?
No, there isn't a standard practice.
So this would be an exception?
It's not an exception, no. We view.
So you've done it in the past?
We have done it in the past. We view each...
The witness reply, please, in full.
I'm trying to get some replies.
We view each matter separately, and we took the view that in this case we were participating heavily in the implementation plan, which is governed by the programme board, of which the SPA is a participating member, and I personally sit on that programme board. So that's how we govern this at the moment.
Could I ask ACC Higgins, do you believe your submission was fair and impartial, your call to evidence?
Yes.
Do you think saying things like it's a sensible move and there will be no detrimental impact is suggesting that you already support the plans to integrate BTP with Police Scotland?
Well, that's my opinion, that it is a sensible move, because if you read the full submission, Mr Ross, what I actually said is that currently Police Scotland looks after the entire transport network in Scotland. We look after the seaports, we look after the airports, we look after the road network. So it would seem sensible that we would also look after the rail network.
You said on the 1st of November, however, when you came to this committee, that you would take no decision prior to Parliament making its view clear. Parliament's not made its view clear, but do you think in your submission you've made it abundantly clear that Police Scotland supports this move without waiting for Parliament to take its decision?
We would never be as presumptuous as to take a decision which is still to go through the parliamentary process. However, I was asked a question in the written submission about my view about whether or not Police Scotland could police the rail network and whether or not we could do it efficiently and effectively. That's what my response reflects.
Mr Foley, you have, or the SPA have suggested, not through written evidence, that you, any concerns over the integration of BTP into Police Scotland, it will be offset by your experience in merging eight police forces. What are the top three issues you took from that merger that will offset the concerns about the possible implications of merging BTP and Police Scotland?
Well, I think, Mr Ross, the first concern or the first issue would be in relation to people. I think it's very important that we address the people matters. Clearly, in this situation, the BTP Federation has raised concerns over the clarity which is required in relation to pensions and terms and conditions. And that's absolutely acceptable, and we support that view. And one of the work streams, which is governed by the programme board, is looking at just that issue. And we're awaiting some clarification from the Scottish Public Pensions Authority, who are due to give an update at the meeting at the end of the month. In terms of the logistics, I think that's very important. We need to make sure that we get the logistics right, and perhaps not associated with the merger of is not associated with the merger of the eight forces. We will need to sit down in this instance with the railways organisations and form a relationship in relation to that.
Sorry, my question was quite specific. I was asking you to give some reassurance to this committee, members of the Scottish Parliament, to people watching this who have concerns about the merger of BTP into Police Scotland, and you have said these concerns are valid concerns, but we have experience in merging eight police forces and two other bodies into one single police force. Therefore, I'm asking for cast iron examples of how you will offset these concerns based on your experience of merging eight police forces, two other bodies, into Police Scotland, because while you may believe it's been a success, others believe it has had its failures and is still having its failures and difficulties, and therefore have concerns about further integration with another body.
Well, in relation to that, Mr Ross, I would respond that we are extremely confident that we will deliver this successfully. My view and the view of the Scottish Police Authority is that we successfully delivered the merging of the eight forces. I can accept your point that other people may have a different view, but that is my view. We have experience of exercises such as this, and I am absolutely confident that we will be able to work with partners, including Scottish Government, including British Transport Police and British Transport Police Authority, and Transport Scotland to deliver.
Wanted to come in at that point?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Just to clarify the question you asked me, Mr Ross, having referred to my written submission, the question I was asking asked me to assess the impact that integration would have. So the question implies that that would be us looking into the future, that this has taken place, and how would Police Scotland cope with that? So my answer referred to or reflected the intent of the question and is not necessarily supporting a process which is still to go through the parliamentary process.
That's interesting then, that your evidence has changed within 5 minutes, having
allowed
yourself
to... No, I don't accept that at all.
Well, I believe that your first answer was to say that you know, your written submission. Well, we won't go into that. Can I ask, before I move on to your British Transport Police colleagues, what is both ECC Higgins and Mr Foley's response to DCC Hanstock, who said to the committee in Westminster that we're looking at this issue, we have not been able to identify any operational or economic benefits of merging BTP into Police Scotland. Do you agree with that comment?
That's Mr Hanstock's view, and I respect his opinion and I respect him as a professional police officer. However, the reality is that within Police Scotland, Police Scotland is the second largest force in the UK with some 17,000 officers and assets that simply are not available to the Police Scotland, to British Transport Police D Division. These assets, whilst we will deploy them on request, will be routinely deployed should integration take place. That then leads to a greater effectiveness, a greater efficiency, and in my view, a greater ability to deploy more resource to locations which currently don't receive them. That's my view, but as I say, I respect Mr Hanstock as a police officer and his professional opinion.
And yes, similarly to ACC Higgins, Mr Ross, I respect Mr Hanstock's view. It would be inappropriate for me to comment on operational policing matters. That, I believe, is a matter reserved for police officers. I am not a police officer. In relation to the economics involved, clearly we are still working through that aspect of it at the moment. I have seen nothing to date to suggest that it will be in detriment, but it's being worked through, so I can't comment on that aspect of it in full.
Chief Constable Crowther, can I ask, are there assets available to D Division at the moment that wouldn't be available to Police Scotland or currently aren't available to Police Scotland?
I think Police Scotland have the full range of specialist capabilities available to them, as you would expect any police force to have. I think the point that we've consistently made in our evidence is that it's the network-wide approach to policing, which is probably the most difficult element to replicate in terms of the proposals for merger. So in terms of operational capabilities, Police Scotland have everything that they would need to do so. It's more around that network-wide assessment of need, the cross-border policing elements of it, which are, if you like, more of a tactical manifestation of the assets that are available.
And would that be why at 2.3 of your evidence you say that BTP's analysis reveals that offensive involving cable theft take on average 33% longer to manage and fatal incidents can take 50% longer by the non-specialist policing?
Yes, that data emanates from some research we did in 2011, I believe, that looked at a range of incidents that were attended by geographic forces, so not specifically Police Scotland, this is UK-wide. So incidents attended by non-BTP resources, typically, if it was, say, a cable theft or an incident like that, are dealt with two-thirds longer if dealt with by a geographic force, in our experience. In the case of a fatality, it can take 50% longer. And in the case of a security-related incident, say an unattended item or a threat, typically, this is UK-wide, a geographic force will err towards closure of the station rather than a risk-based approach. That's research not specifically around Police Scotland or in the Scottish context, it's UK-wide.
If you can wind up this line of question, because I'll bring others in now, Fulton Scott, supplementary.
Then I'll ask a final question to Mrs. Vitty, if I can. We heard Mr. Foley saying, although not able, I think I'm fair to say, to give any concrete examples of how he would offset any of the concerns about merger, given their experience of merging eight police forces. But you state in your evidence quite clearly this is not the same as merging eight police forces. This is quite different. Could you maybe expand on that for the committee?
Yes, absolutely. I think that the Chief alluded to the fact that we are a specialist police force, and we have different capabilities from the Home Office forces, certainly towards our approach to the railway, obviously. That alone makes us unique outside of the Home Office forces. And I think, I believe, you know, the way we approach our strategy and how we integrate and operate with the rail companies is a really strong quality of ours. And we get a lot of value out of that very close relationship.
The reassurances from Police Scotland would not necessarily mitigate all the concerns you have, because you see these mergers, Police Scotland being established and BTP coming into Police Scotland, as being quite distinctly separate.
I think as part of the programme board, we are absolutely putting forward how we approach to do our business, because we think that's really vital to make this a success for the Scottish Police Authority, to understand how we approach it so they can potentially mirror and align with our approach.
Right, three supplementaries. If you could be brief, if it's going to be too long and I think you're wandering off, then I'll stop you. Fulton.
Thanks, Convener. It's just a very brief supplementary. Can I ask the panel members if it's their understanding, as it is mine, that all political parties agreed to this devolution through the Smith Commission? And as I say, I'll take a brief answer on that.
Convener, if I could start, totally accept that the Smith Commission recommendations taken forward in the Scottish, the Scotland Act, bring about the devolution of the functions of British Transport Police within Scotland. There's no, absolutely no doubt about that, and we totally support that. The means by which that's done have been subject of this debate. And British Transport Police will support whatever the decision of Parliament is to make that happen.
Choice of legislative, administrative, or a mixture of both, and that's a fact. John Finney.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, panel, and thanks for your evidence. It's just a quick supplementary, if I may, to Mr. Crowther. You made reference, Mr. Crowther, to the evidence about the time taken if it's not BTP that attend. And I wonder if a twofold question, if I may, please, if there's an opportunity with merger for that better experience to be shared more widely, and I understand particularly in relation to fatalities, BTP have an excellent record of dealing with that. There's an opportunity for that. And as a representative for the Highlands and Islands, a vast tract of land, the reality is that, and I think it would be inappropriate to discuss the resources you do have necessarily in that area, but the reality is that it's Mr. Higgins' officers that are most, that are going to attend, really, in the vast, overwhelming majority of instances.
So I'll take the first question first, if I may. So the approach that we take to dealing with incidents is steeped in what I call the transport policing ethos. I believe there's something substantially different about transport policing than geographic policing, because it requires a comprehensive understanding of the impact of how an organisation fulfils its statutory functions. And the approach that we have is embedded and steeped in the organisation over decades of transport policing. It is our single focus, and therefore it's our expertise. That ethos can be shared, and it's right to say that at the point of merger, that ethos would be within those people who transferred into Police Scotland. There's no doubt about that. The challenge, I think, is how you maintain that ethos and continue it on to, you know, beyond the first year, for example. If you look at some of the turnover figures within BTP, and indeed some of the figures around the people who will be approaching retirement age around the proposed date of merger, then there is an interesting and significant outflow of expertise and transport policing ethos, and that then needs to be replenished. It's replenished in an organisation that has that as its sole focus. I think it will be a real challenge to replenish that ethos in an organisation whose focus is in many other areas of policing rather than transport policing. So it's in the first instance, I've got no doubt that those people who transfer across would continue to adopt the same approach. It's how that's sustained in the future. And indeed, if, as is proposed, people are able to move into other functions within Police Scotland, that's beneficial to those individuals, but perhaps also diminishes the transport policing ethos. Those are some of the challenges I think that we've been pointing out. On your second point, it's a fact that in some areas of Scotland, as in other parts of the United Kingdom, the geographic force is often first at the incident. BTP adopt those cases and implement our approach to the way that we deal with things. So my example around how geographic forces, if they deal with incidents in the past, have demonstrated that they can take longer, our aim, our strategy, is get there as quickly as we can, implement our transport policing ethos, and make sure that the policing of the transport network is done in the way that takes account of the impact on the running of the railway.
But that, of course, could involve a 3 or 4 hour drive for resources from some considerable distance away. Whereas Police Scotland could have resources along the way.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Was there some mention before I bring in Mary of a specialist fleet of high performance cards to make sure that the British Transport Police could get the officers who have the expertise to a particularly challenging incident? Was there some...
You're not familiar with.
Right. I was led to believe that given the geographical business, there were high performance vehicles available to police transport because they had to get the people with the expertise to cover a large distance. And I think it was taking on the point it's not necessarily who's geographically nearest, but ensuring the right person attends with the right expertise.
Absolutely. And I think there is no doubt that across the UK, geographic forces often attend in the first instance on behalf of BTP. Often we are influencing in the background and speaking to control rooms about what the approach should be there. But I don't for a minute dismiss the support that we get from other forces.
Yeah. Maria, supplementary, thank the others for being brief.
I was on the point that John Finney raised there, because it was really to ask, how are British Transport Police officers currently deployed in Scotland? Where are their bases? I represent a rural area as well, and I think it would probably be one of those cases where it would be the geographical force that would potentially be the first on scene. On the back of that as well is, you talk about the ethos, how the ethos could be shared. It's also to ask Mr. Higgins, how you see there's concerns there about that being maintained beyond the first initial transfer, and just how you would see that operating into the future, and how that ethos would continue into Police Scotland if that's what goes ahead.
So BTP resources are distributed at a number of locations across Scotland. The major bases are in Edinburgh and Glasgow. There are places in Dundee and Perth and Aberdeen and other locations. The concentration of those resources are in those major conurbations and cities. And I don't think that we have at any stage said that much of the day-to-day policing of incidents that happen on the railways could not be dealt with by Police Scotland. I don't think we've said that at all. I think we make a particular point about the challenges that we identify, about those specific disruption-related incidents that come to bear, and also particularly the cross-border elements, the bits with the services that cross between Scotland and England. And it's a particular area of particular focus of mine in any transfer of responsibilities, that those arrangements and indeed the policing powers that will exist for the officers, whichever way they're travelling across that border that will be created, are full and are protected, such that people can effectively protect the public going forward. So I hope I've answered your question in that respect.
I suppose I understand that you say you have your resources focused in each of the city areas, but realistically, in terms of numbers, how does that look on a day-to-day basis, like further up north when you're outside the central belt? What sort of numbers are we looking at here?
I haven't got those numbers to hand. I can certainly supply them to you. It's without doubt that it's more thinly spread in the outlying areas.
Right. Yeah. And I suppose on the back of that then, I would just ask, would it not be the case then that if BTP and
police, were part of Police Scotland, if we were able to train more officers in that respect, that it's almost that the first response to it would be better in that first response to an incident if more officers of Police Scotland underwent specialist training in that regard as well, that we would have more officers on the ground more readily available and to deal with these situations as they occur.
Well, I think you hit on actually one of the issues which through the Joint Programme Board we're taking forward. So there are some specialist training requirements for people who operate within the railway environment. Specialist training around track safety, how to operate in what is a particularly dangerous environment, and not insurmountable by any means, but that will require a great deal of thought about how those officers are trained and distributed across Police Scotland such that they can respond and be able to deal effectively with things in a very different environment. Mm-hmm. Not insurmountable, but one of the challenges that are highlighted.
Okay, Ms. Evans, there's a couple of points here that I'll hopefully clarify. The first one is around ethos, and Mr. Crowther's absolutely correct. There is a very strong ethos within British Transport Policing, and it's one that we would want to retain. But actually, if you look at the history of Police Scotland, the ethos is pretty much the same right across the whole force area, which is around keeping people safe and protecting Scotland's communities, which I'm sure is the same desire of British Transport Police in terms of the travelling Scottish community. But what I would say is that one of the strengths of Police Scotland isn't necessarily our single ethos and our single keeping people safe, but it's the multicultures that we have within the organisation. You know, the culture of policing in Mr. Finney's area in the Highlands and Islands is completely different to that policing Glasgow City Centre or Edinburgh City Centre. The culture within my firearms unit will be different to the culture that's within our community safety officers. But actually the diversity of the cultures within policing makes it a strength because it then is reflective of the communities we serve right across what is essentially a third of the UK landmass. So we would be embracing what clearly is an excellent and good practice within British Transport Police, and actually unashamedly squeezing the good practice in terms of how fatalities in the line and other crimes in the line are dealt with, because there's no doubt, you know, within 90 minutes BTP can have the line opened up. There's got to be some absolute learning there. So it's not about bringing British Transport Police in and throwing everything that they've done over the last couple of 100 years out with it. That would just be foolish. And again, to give you some assurance around that, when Police Scotland merged, the smallest force in the UK at the time was Dumfries and Galloway, but actually it had the best process for dealing with licensing inquiries. And my understanding is, whilst it's not my area of responsibility, the processes that were in Dumfries and Galloway have now been rolled out right across the whole nation. So there is evidence that we do look to see, you know, where the best practice is, and we roll that out. In terms of your point around training, you know, should the will of Parliament be that this legislation is passed, then we will go on an upskill programme for existing officers. But in addition to that, every new recruit to Police Scotland, we will extend the initial probationary period from 11 weeks to probably 13 or 14 to incorporate the additional training that current British Transport Police students studying at the Police College Tully Allen receive once they've passed the Scottish training. So yeah, your point is correct that post 19, then every Police Scotland officer would be trained in policing the railways. I'm not making light of the task and how that would be, and we would rely heavily in British Transport Police in supporting us in delivering that training and actually making sure their training was fit for purpose. But that would be our plan, which ultimately would mean that pretty much every officer in Scotland would have some knowledge of how to police the railways, with a great many having a specific and specialist knowledge over and above those who would be deployed on a full-time basis within the transport environment.
Thank you. Well, I don't want to rain in your parade, Mr. Higgins, then having been down to Dumfries and Galloway as part of seeing how Police Scotland was operating, then the overall complaint, overwhelming complaint, was that local issues and the responses they had already developed and that were working very well were being overawed by what they saw as Strathclyde region large. So while I've no doubt the objective was, as you've just said, I think perhaps we are some distance away from ensuring we've actually achieved that. And that's fundamental to looking at how we can integrate BTP into Police Scotland. Moving on now, Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you very much, Convener. And let me just, for completeness, say I have a close family member who's a constable at Police Scotland. And indeed, my wife's family is full of policemen, north and south of the border. I want to just go into the issue of specialisms with perhaps particularly the two chief constables. And perhaps Chief Constable Crowther first, just simply to ask, within British Transport Police, the GB network, have you specialisms within that service?
Absolutely, yes. So within British Transport Police, we have the full range of specialisms that you would expect to find in any police force, counter-terrorism experts, intelligence, firearms, safeguarding, just about everything that you would expect to find in an organisation that polices across a transient population, 3.2 billion passenger journeys last year, which is an interesting statistic in terms of how you engage with people and how you deal with that influx and the threat that perhaps surrounds crowded places that go with those people. So we have a range of specialisms, and particularly in areas to deal with fatalities and suicide prevention that have been developed specifically for our environment.
So it is a natural part of any police service that it will be necessary to develop specialisms to protect these and to make sure that they deliver on their particular requirements that they have to undertake, intelligence being, particularly in transport, I guess, one of the more important ones.
Yes, and I imagine in the same way Police Scotland develops its own structures and processes to deal with the different elements of and communities within Scotland that Mr. Higgins referred to, we have to develop specific structures within our organisation that allows us to integrate and engage with 43 police forces in England and Wales and Police Scotland and the various local authorities and the structures that go with that, including the intelligence sharing networks that take account of travelling criminals and transient issues that go with the transient nature of the population.
Right. Now, turning to Police Constable Higgins, I would be interested to know roughly how many specialisms there might be currently in Police Scotland. Clearly, you've made reference to firearms. I identified for my own purposes one area that I think has benefited from the merger, which is wildlife crime, where it used to be Tayside and now it's Scotland-wide. Dogs, traffic, and these are only the ones I can think of. So presumably, Police Scotland, like British Transport Police, are well used to having protected resources for particular specialism, developing, nurturing, training for these. Is that a correct characterisation of Police Scotland?
Yes, sir. I would say that in UK terms, we are probably one of the most well-equipped forces in the UK. In terms of not just the number of specialisms we have, but the number of people trained in those specialisms. And we have specialisms which probably aren't relevant to this debate, which other forces in the wider UK don't have. You know, so, for example, we're one of the few remaining forces in the UK that have a mounted section and a diving marine unit. As I say, not relevant to this debate, but we invest heavily in specialisms to make sure that we can deal with any eventuality.
So the nearly 70 ferry services that are operating in Scotland, the ones that are within your remit, a very important part of Scotland's transport infrastructure already.
Yeah, we have the Border Policing Command that look after both the airports and the seaports, and again we have specialist officers deployed to all those locations.
So does that permit, therefore, the development of particular and specific ethoses in these specialist units? I would imagine that a firearms officer has a particular approach to the way he or she may do their job that is quite particular to that unit, and the same might be true for other units, as it might be if you become responsible for railway policing in the future.
Yeah, I guess it just goes back to my earlier answer, sir, that across the whole policing network in Scotland, there are different cultures which reflect local circumstances, but also the duties that the officers are carrying out. Firearms officers, for example, are very precise. There is no room for manoeuvre, no room for mistake. Community policing is far more flexible, it's far more fluid, it's far more involved with the community. Two different cultures, necessity to do their job, but actually the overarching ethos is all around public safety. It's about keeping the communities of Scotland safe. And to me, one glove does not fit all, and you have to react to local circumstance in the operating environment, and very much respectful of the operating environment which the British Transport Police officers currently operate, and we would not want to lose that.
So I take it then, and just to pick one area, such as intelligence, which is an important part because transport in general has been a subject of terrorist attack in Scotland as elsewhere, and public order at the other end of the difficulties. That where intelligence is concerned, if the railway is brought in, that presumably reduces the number of communications that the central intelligence services have to have and can bring perhaps a wider view that may benefit Scotland. It's up to Mr. Foley and his team and yourself to deliver on that, but there is that opportunity there which can be delivered.
And certainly, I mean, Police Scotland, as I said, out with the Metropolitan Police, we are the largest force in the UK, and as such comes a massive responsibility in terms of our responsibility to support the UK counter-terrorist network, which we are a key and pivotal player in. You know, so for example, our crime campus at Gartcosh is state-of-the-art, where we have a number of partner agencies, both from law enforcement and wider government agencies. We have direct linkage into real-time intelligence with the agencies all across the country and down in London. And again, we feed back into that as well. You know, so, you know, for example, our counter-terrorist police operations room, where a counter-terrorist operation could run from run any part of the UK, is one of a limited number of such facilities in the whole of the UK.
So you have the scale to do these big things, mm-hmm. but also protecting small things. I mean, for example, how big is the wildlife crime unit?
We have an assistant chief constable who has portfolio responsibility for it, and dependent on where you are in the country. So, for example, in Mr. Finney's area, we have a full-time officer, but throughout our whole 13 local policing divisions, we have at least one single point of contact officer who has that subject matter expertise.
So, in relation to transport police being integrated into the operation, we've got an example of what is a really very small unit that nonetheless is able to operate within that very large unit that is Police Scotland and has access to all the resources. So we have in that, without talking too much about the detail of that, we have an example of how things can be done.
Yes, we have a number of small units that operate nationally across the entire force. You know, public protection officers, our domestic abuse teams, small in number but high in impact, and they are located in every geographical area in the force.
Thank you, Convener.
Stuart Stephen mentioned terrorism, and the Gartcosh unit is state of the art. The liaison work well just now under the current arrangement with British Transport Police?
Yes, as the answer. You know, we've run a number of operations over the years with British Transport Police, whether it be crime-related, whether it be football-related, and there's never been any problem with that. You know, what tends to happen is British Transport will put an officer into our events room or our control room, and they will be the single point of contact. So there is that real-time live interaction, and it's never been an operational challenge at all, and it's worked very well.
I suppose the question is then, why mess with that? Why change the arrangement when it's operating and it's such an important area UK-wide?
Well, again, that's a matter for Parliament to determine. What we are saying is that should Parliament determine that this is to happen, these are the arrangements going forward, which would be currently at our intelligence cells in Gartcosh, we have access to real lifetime information, which then has to be relayed out of Gartcosh to British Transport Police or other partners who aren't represented within the Gartcosh Crime Campus. In the future, if BTP Scotland was part of a wider Police Scotland, then there would be no need for that relay. The information would be put directly to the point where it's required.
Mr. Crowther.
Convener, thank you. I think this is a really interesting element of the discussion, if I may. And there is a risk that we fall into a little bit of a trap of looking at this from a geographic policing perspective, in that Police Scotland have got first-class counter-terrorism capabilities and work really closely with us and other forces, security services, etc. What we're talking about, I think, is the challenge of assessing terrorist threat and across the network. So trains which start in Scotland and finish in England or vice versa, and how decisions are made about threat and risk in relation to matters which could be in one or other of the jurisdictions but have a significant impact depending on what decision is made elsewhere. One of the significant challenges which we will be working closely with Police Scotland on is to be really clear about decision making. So if there is a bomb threat or a risk to a line of route, who is the decision maker in terms of that process, such that there can be no doubts about where that decision has been made, and that there's a proper assessment of the implications of that decision along the route of those particular trains. And I think that is the nub of the issue from my perspective. It's about that network-wide perspective rather than the very specific and very skillful set of capabilities within Police Scotland.
Okay. A supplementary, John Finney?
Mr. Crowther, you'll be responsible at the moment for trains, that, of course, that run through several police jurisdictions. I mean, so it'd be wrong to suggest that there aren't any set of circumstances that haven't already been encountered about, you know, areas of responsibility.
Well, of course, at the moment, we are responsible for the trains and the rail network that runs across England, Wales and Scotland. So the issues that I'm referring to don't tend to occur because we make the decisions. So if there's a bomb threat in relation to the rail network, then we make the decisions, not the geographic force.
But you'll make that decision in conjunction with the geographic force, because, of course, there'll be implications for that threat out with the rail network.
Well, indeed, and we take into account we would liaise particularly closely with the Metropolitan Police Counter-Terrorism Command and Security Services and the Geographic Force in terms of what might underpin the particular threat or any background information. But ultimately, that decision is made by us.
But my concern is that, I mean, I understand people's different perspectives on this, but yeah, it'd be wrong to give any suggestion that there might be a grey area on such an important matter as terrorism. There are issues about demarcations that must exist already. You talk about the different relationship there, the geographic force yourselves, and UK
yes,
security services.
I think what I'm highlighting is the proposals add an additional layer of complexity, which are not insurmountable, but become a really important element of the planning for such a move as proposed, because it will be different to the current structures. There isn't that. Break in decision-making currently. And so we need to make sure that the added complexity does not add risk to it. It's not insurmountable, but I highlight it as one of the key areas that we must focus on.
But there's equally an argument that could be made if you've three players in the decision-making process, so you've got a UK strategic, you've got yourselves, which I appreciate at the moment is UK, and you've the geographic force. Moving from three to two takes out a layer, and that would be beneficial.
Sorry, I'm not quite with you.
Well, if you've two people making decisions of that importance, surely that's better than necessarily three people or three command structures to be satisfied.
I'm not sure whether three comes in.
Well, you said that there's liaison at a UK strategic level with the like of the security services.
Yeah, so what we're talking about, bomb threats that come in, typically, or other threats, we would liaise with other agencies that might have intelligence or information that's relevant to the decision. That would be a natural course that any police force would do. And then a decision is made by British Transport Police in that regard. What I'm saying is we need to ensure and work really closely to be clear about how that decision making will be made in future. It's not insurmountable, but it's a very important element that we need to work really closely with Police Scotland to develop.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Good morning. I think my question is probably for Charlotte, Vitty and Paul Crowther. I'd like to ask you about the sort of governance arrangements immediately following the devolution of railway policing. Do you think that will go seamlessly? Has everything been planned for that? And also, I suppose what I'm really asking is, do you think the public will be aware of any difference?
The joint programme boards are part of one of the strategic boards is the governance. And we have 2 years to make sure that we are working together, supporting Scottish Police Authority on how we approach our governance, certainly in terms of how we work with the travelling public, the railway staff and the rail industry. So I think we have come to that board very actively. We are making sure that we're highlighting all the risks to make sure this is its success rather than it being something that is they find out later on. So I think we're trying to approach it in a very open and transparent way, and they've certainly been invited to our authority board to look at how we actually do our governance.
Mr. Crowther?
I think the governance and the financial issues are primarily the focus of the authority, but I think I'd agree with everything that Charlotte said.
I mean, the reason I'm asking is because obviously what you're saying is vitally important, but from the public's perception, they want to just know that they're going to be safe, safe on trains, and that, there's nothing changed because of a difference in arrangement. So you're quite confident that won't happen, that the public will be still reassured that everything's going to be fine?
I think that we spend an awful lot of time obviously working on our strategy and doing lots of consultation. I know the Police Scotland and the Scottish Police Authority have released their 10-year strategy, and I think it's really important that we start to look at how we can align our strategy with theirs moving forwards to ensure that there is seamless.
So that's a priority for you?
Well, it's a priority for us, obviously, because leading up to devolution. Uh-huh. However, the responsibility post 1 second past devolution date will absolutely lie with the Scottish Police Authority, which we will support.
Thank you. Maybe I could widen it to the Scottish Police Authority and the...
Yes, indeed, Ms. Mackay. We have recently published our Policing 2026 strategy, as you will be aware. We have introduced a policing committee within the authority, which is welcome. It's something I've been promoting for a number of years. And the transport police will form part of the governance of that policing committee should it pass through Parliament. So we have a chair on the policing committee who is George Graham, who's a former chief constable and former Her Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary in Scotland. So it is well chaired by someone who knows policing, and I think that's a positive. So I believe that the public can take assurance from the proposals that we have in place to govern.
Thank you. And can you just clarify, have discussions with rail operators begun, and have they raised any concerns about the transitional period or how it's all going to operate?
If I could perhaps come in there, we have a meeting with rail operators tomorrow involving the Transport Secretary. That's the first time that I personally will have met with the railway authorities, and hopefully one of the outcomes from that meeting will be a plan to move forward to actually to get me and others into a room with the railway people moving forward to discuss the matters of importance. BTPA will, of course, I'm sure, will have met and do meet on an ongoing basis with the railway people, but Charlotte will.
I sit as part of the Rail Delivery Group Police and Security Board, and we report into them regularly, and it's obviously been on their agenda for quite some time. And what's really vital for us is that they understand how we're supporting the process up until devolution, and then really about what we're safeguarding and making sure we support post the devolution with the remaining England and Wales functions.
Thank you.
Yes, Vitty.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to start by asking a very brief follow-on question to the question that John Finney asked. And I wonder if perhaps Mr Higgins and Mr Crowther could give me an example of currently what collaboration exists between BTP and Police Scotland. How would you speak to each other and collaborate if there was an incident on the line currently?
Well, there's two types of collaboration, ma'am. The first one is a pre-planned event, you know, so in the last year, I think there's been 11 football matches where travelling supporters from either England or Scotland have made the journey. We have deployed Police Scotland officers down to England in support of the host force. Equally so, English officers have come up here, and the rail network has been critical to that. We have the planning arrangements for example, the Old Firm game this Sunday, which again we'll see fans from both sets of supporters using the rail network. And in our events room on Sunday, there will be an officer from British Transport Police providing that single point of contact right in the heart of the event control, making sure that the joint operation between us works seamlessly. So that's a pre-planned event. Spontaneous event tends to be contact from the control centre, either our own control centre to Birmingham or vice versa, to say that we've either come across an incident and asking for BTP officers to attend and assist, or exactly the traverse, British Transport Police contact us through their command centre to ask us to go and assist until BTP officers either get there or alternatively to assist actual BT officers on scene. It's fairly straightforward, I'd say.
Okay. Mr Crowther, is there anything you would like to add?
I'd support everything that Mr Higgins has said. I think what will be different going forward is that those officers that are bringing or taking football supporters, for example, to or from Scotland would be a mixture of British Transport Police officers, England and Wales, and what would then be Police Scotland officers. And I think one of my my key aims is to understand the legislative framework that will provide the powers to those officers, whichever way they're going, that make sure that they are fully fledged constables, able to carry out their duties wherever they might be on that journey. And there are existing legislative proposals, arrangements, for example, for that exist throughout the UK for a constable to act to arrest in any part of the UK, if that's the case. But I think there are some particular issues that we need to consider in this regard, in that officers on board trains escorting supporters, if we use that example, will find themselves between England and Scotland, sometimes not knowing precisely where they are, whether they're from the last station in England travelling to Scotland or vice versa. And I'm really keen to ensure that there's no ambiguity about what powers people have, what legislation they're acting under, which laws they are enforcing during that process. And I think it goes beyond the existing arrangements for cross-border jurisdictions that are currently in place. I think a really good example is the way that we police the Channel Tunnel, and there are specific protocols in place that make it very clear at that point of time where an officer doesn't know whether they're in England or France, who can do what and what jurisdiction they're in. And I'm very keen to ensure that the legislative arrangements put in place for this cross-border policing are as clear as they are for when we're policing into France.
Okay. And have you been given an indication that if the integration goes ahead, that you will have the BTP will have the opportunity to be fully involved in that process?
I'm assured that the jurisdictional arrangements can be dealt with within a Section 104 or a Section 90 order. I'm sure I'll be involved in that, and I'll be scrutinising carefully to make sure that we learn the lessons of other jurisdictions where we police across borders.
Okay. Mr Higgins, can you confirm that that will be the case?
Yes, certainly, ma'am. Currently, as Mr Crowther said, there are existing legislative arrangements which, you know, for example, Police Scotland deployed several hundred officers in support of the G20 conference in Cardiff, I think it was, and also the G8 conference over in Northern Ireland, which allowed them to operate as officers of the law in that jurisdiction. So there is current legislation. Again, Mr Crowther's quite correct. When an officer's on a train, he might not know particularly what part of the country they're in, so it is vitally important that the cross-border legislation is all-encompassing. And again, we are content that we are fully engaged and fully aware of those discussions.
Okay. Thank you. A couple more, if that's all right. I'll make one brief and one longer. Has consideration of the integration been given when the Policing 2026 strategy was drawn up?
Yes, is the short answer, but if I could expand it ever so slightly. The 2026 strategy is actually a consultation document just now. It's not actually been finalised. And I had a chat with Malcolm Graham, who is the Police Scotland lead on it. And my view is that it would be presumptuous of us to put in a 10-year strategy, you know, something around the integration of British Transport Police before Parliament had the chance to debate it. I thought it would be disrespectful of the parliamentary process in that regard. However, be assured, should it be the will of Parliament that this happens, then the integration of BTP will form a critical part of our sustainable policing model moving forward.
Okay, thank you. Can I just ask one more?
Yes,
one
more.
Currently, British Transport Police have different terms and conditions from Police Scotland. Will the staff be guaranteed, the BTP staff that transfer over, will they be given a guarantee that they will keep their existing terms and conditions?
I'm going to unashamedly pass this over to the police authority to answer. However, I have been assured by senior members of Scottish Government that that is the desire, and they are working furiously to ensure that the current conditions in service of all staff in British Transport Police will be honoured on transfer. But perhaps Mr Foley could give you a more detailed answer.
Thank you.
Yes, indeed, Ms Fee. As Mr Higgins said, it is the intention, so far as I'm aware, of government to ensure there is no detriment to officers, and indeed we have, and staff, and indeed we have mentioned this in this committee before. Where we are at the moment, I mentioned at the beginning, we are looking at the pension situation, so the Scottish Public Pensions Authority to present in relation to options towards the end of this month. We have the next programme board meeting, and clearly that forms part of terms and conditions, but overall we will be looking at that aspect. But in my belief, that is the intention as we move forward.
Okay. Can I just come back to you then, Mr Higgins, because in a previous answer you said that currently people training at Tully Allen do 11 weeks or so. And if BTP are integrated in Police Scotland, the training that people will be given will be extended to 13, 14 weeks to include training on transport issues. So after 2019, will you have one force with one set of terms and conditions?
Currently, within Police Scotland, there are a number of officers that retain legacy terms and conditions. For example, I'm one of a dying breed of officer that retains a housing allowance, and officers that joined on or after 1994, I think it was, no longer receive a housing allowance. However, I joined in 88, so that's a grandfather right that will stay with me until I retire. So I'm entirely comfortable that people transferring in and retain their rights is no different to current current legacy arrangements within Police Scotland.
And how will you deal with, because it's been reported that there are some officers with BTP that don't want to transfer to Police Scotland. Have you done any work to try and establish the number and how you will deal with that?
No. Whilst at my level and the Chief's level, it's right for us to be having these discussions. Again, until Parliament decides whether this legislation is going to be enacted or not, then I thought it would be inappropriate to go and actually engage with the staff on the ground. However, should Parliament decide that this is to be enacted, then that will be very much one of our first key tasks, to go in and sit down and speak to the staff and listen to the concerns and give them reassurance. And actually, in many ways, it's similar to the legacy arrangements when Police Scotland came together. You know, there was nervousness across the country that people, working in Inverness were suddenly going to get transferred to Glasgow, and that simply hasn't materialised. And what we have said to people within Police Scotland is that, you know, if your will is that you want to, you know, you joined Northern Constabulary and your will is that you want to stay within that geographical area for the remainder of your service, then we will respect that. But it's all about early communication at the right time. And my assessment, being respectful to British Transport Police and the parliamentary processes, now is not the right time for Police Scotland officers to go and engage with current BTP officers.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Crowther, did you want to come
in? Yes, thank you. So, Convener, up with my concern that we ensure that the public continue to be protected as best we can, is my concern about the way that my staff are treated in any transfer. During what's been 2 years or more of discombobulating times for them, if I can use that term, they have excelled and they have shown their professionalism. And performance has increased at a time when you might expect that people were somewhat dismayed by the uncertainty. There is a particular difference in this transfer than there would be in any other, as you're probably aware. So the constables of British Transport Police are employees. They're constables and employees rather than Crown servants. And that presents a particularly interesting conundrum in terms of how they are transferred into Police Scotland. And there are a range of options that could flow from that. My understanding is that the intent is to transfer them in their current status, so as employees, Scottish Police Authority is one of the options, which I think is one of the favoured options. And I think people understand that. I'm really keen that whatever happens, and whatever happens thereafter in terms of synchronising terms and conditions, that people are treated fairly and with the respect that they deserve. And I'm encouraged by the Scottish Government's commitment to the triple lock approach around terms and conditions and pensions, etc. But I think there are some particularly interesting twists and turns in how this transfer can take place. And I think from the staff's perspective, the earlier that those can be shared with them, the quicker we'll be able to work with individuals to understand what that means to them in their individual circumstances.
Can we just be quite clear that it's unlikely that the transfer of undertakings legislation will apply, and that's one of the reasons there is such an issue?
My understanding, yes.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Why is that? Why wouldn't the transfer of undertaking?
I'm not sure I understand myself why it doesn't apply. I've just been, the sort of legal advice I've seen is that it doesn't, but that the Cabinet Office guidance, which is effectively use the same principles as 2P, would apply.
Mr. Foley, can you shed any light on why?
Yes, the principles would be the same, and that is something that we've all signed up to. And, you know, we are absolutely committed to ensuring that the officers and staff are treated fairly, as if they were transferring under the 2P regulations.
But no one can give me a direct answer of why 2P doesn't apply?
No, but I can undertake, Convener, to give you a written response to that subsequent to the meeting.
That would be very helpful.
Thank you.
Fulton, a supplementary?
Thanks, Convener. It is actually a wee bit back to an earlier point in Mary Fee's line of questioning, so I do apologise for that. But we heard a good example earlier from Mr. Crowther regarding the border arrangements between England and France. And I was really quite heartened to hear that's not regarded as an issue and regarded as a positive factor. And I think that's something obviously we'd like to see going forward from all stakeholders involved when the sort of devolution occurs. But I'm just wondering from Police Scotland, from Mr. Higgins' point of view, is the France-England arrangement something that Police Scotland will be looking at?
Well, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, again, it would be foolish not to not to look at best practice elsewhere. But, you know, we are on the border with England. And if you look at our divisions in Jai Division in particular and Dumfries and Galloway, we have very strong working relationships currently with the likes of Cumbria Constabulary, with the likes of Northumbria Constabulary, and it's not unusual for one of these forces to be first responders to provide assistance to Police Scotland. You know, recently we had a robbery at a bank and it was a Cumbria police dog van that came to assist in tracking for the suspect. You know, so there are arrangements already in place for cross-border policing. But to answer your question, yes, the France Channel Tunnel interest is greatly.
Thanks. Okay, Ben.
Thank you, Convener. Again, touching on some of the earlier themes, but first of all, I'm encouraged from Mr. Foley's statements earlier about as appropriate implementation consideration is already taking place. And I know we had the discussion about pensions at the previous evidence committee, so it's good to hear that things are moving forward on that. Getting back to the ethos and the specialist nature of the skills that are required in this area of policing, I just wanted to touch on the issue of abstraction that was raised at certain points. Obviously, the economies of scale and the operational capability advantage that the merger into Police Scotland will bring. I just wanted some reassurance and comment around the issue of whether officers will be abstracted from other parts of the operational requirement of Police Scotland, and whether any consideration is being given to that in terms of the upskilling that you talked about earlier. Yes, we want to build the capacity and maintain the current specialist knowledge that is there, but I think also consideration needs to be given to make sure that there's resources are allocated appropriately.
Certainly, Mr. McPherson, I'll address that directly. I mean, firstly, I've gone on record publicly to say that any British Transport officer that migrates into Police Scotland, then their legacy right to police the railways will be honoured. And if they choose to remain within the railway environment for the remainder of their career, then that will be respected. We will sign service level agreements with the rail operators, which will require us to provide exactly that, the level of resource which we've agreed with the rail providers. I said in my written response that the Chief Constable, in times of crisis, reserves the right to deploy officers as he sees fit. The reality is, you know, for example, if it was a terrorist attack, then the resources at the rail network are going to be strengthened, not diluted, because the rail network is a key national infrastructure. So if we had a major incident, which was a security-based, then rather than remove officers from the transport network, we are going to increase it. Similarly, with the upskilling of officers, that will allow us to deploy into the rail environments where currently, as the Chief has mentioned, that there are areas of Scotland where that doesn't currently exist. So as part of the routine duties that these officers would patrol, it gives them the added advantage of being able to operate in that environment. But the crux of your matter is that I will give an assurance that any British Transport Police officer that transfers into Police Scotland and wishes to remain within the railway network, that will be honoured and respected.
Thank you. And that assurance is hugely welcome, as is the determination to increase the capacity. And I think that was good to hear that piece earlier. Thank you.
Can I ask specifically about delays in the various forms? Because I notice this comes strongly through in the BTP and BTPA submissions that they have particular expertise at looking at the various situations which may cause delays. If I took, for example, abandoned luggage and hoax calls, where it's estimated that the cost associated with the temporary closing of a station is in the region of £2 million, and the impact, obviously, on the operators and their financing. Could you talk in some more length about that?
Yes, Convener. So this, I guess, goes to the heart of many of the issues that we've talked about today. So it's about a network-wide decision-making. It's about appreciation of the impact of decisions, not just at the location, but elsewhere, and goes to the heart of the transport policing ethos and understanding it. So, as you'll imagine, there are thousands of unattended items left on the railway every year. Each one of those is a potential suspect bag and a closure. And we have network-wide, well-rehearsed approaches to how we deal with that, and indeed how we deal with bomb threats, which might actually seem like something from the past. It was very prevalent during the distant Irish Republican campaigns in the 80s and 90s, but we still, it's not unusual perhaps for us to have to assess 20, 25, 30 bomb threats in a month across the network. And that requires a thought process based on risk management so that we react appropriately to those incidents that need to be reacted to. And we also react proportionately to what are in effect benign incidents, and you can sort out sort of the real incidents from the ones that might otherwise distract. And I guess that goes to the heart of the approach, is how you take those decisions. Equally, in terms of the way that we deal with fatalities, if I look back in our past, as you know, I've been in transport policing for 37 years. In our past, we didn't have as finely tuned approach as there is now. I'm going back a long time now. But national policing protocols, in the case of death, guide policing towards assume it's a murder and work downwards, when actually, with a very thoughtful, evidence-based approach, you can allow people to make judgments around what the likely cause of a fatality is, and therefore determine the response accordingly. That takes lots of training, that takes lots of leadership and support, and I guess goes to the heart of what we've identified during all of our evidence. We don't doubt Police Scotland's professionalism, but it's how you maintain that and how you deliver that, take into account the network-wide implications.
In particular, suicide seems to be something that has been finely tuned over the years, and a programme of suicide prevention is now very much at the heart of BTB. Could you talk to that in some...
Yes. We have a specialism we developed around safeguarding of people who might harm themselves. I'm the National Police Lead for National Police Chiefs Council for Suicide Prevention. And we've developed a range of initiatives that identify those at risk, implement measures to divert them away from it, but also to deal with the consequences in terms of not just the very tragic and sad death of that individual and reporting to the coroner, but also the consequential impacts on the network. Last year, either my officers or rail employees, or sometimes members of the public, made 1,279 life-saving interventions. A life-saving intervention is literally someone who's restrained from jumping or is removed from the tracks in close proximity to death. 1,279 of those delivered by a very clear focus on safeguarding of people who are drawn to the railway for some very sad and tragic reasons. And that's one of the specialisms that we've developed within British Transport Police.
Just before we move on to a supplementary, that will Police Scotland integrate the National Rail Suicide Prevention Programme?
Absolutely. I mean, as Mr. Crowther said, you know, you can't argue with the number of suicide interventions. I mean, within Police Scotland, we have a large number of negotiators. Our negotiator cadre is deployed right across the entire Police Scotland estate, and one of the key training elements that they have is suicide intervention. But anywhere where we can grab best practice and implement it, because ultimately it's about saving lives, we'd absolutely do.
Okay. Supplementary, Rona, then Mary.
Yes, just a brief question. Is there specialist counselling available for British Transport Police at the moment, and will that continue? And is it different from the counselling that I assume police officers get?
Thank you. It's a really important element of our wellbeing support to our officers. We ask them to do some very, very difficult things. Some of my officers individually deal with 12 or 15 railway fatalities each per year, each of which are pretty traumatic, as you might understand. But there are a range of other people who are also involved in this. So part of our ethos in terms of dealing professionally with the incident and supporting the bereaved families and reporting to the coroner is to make the assessment of how we can try to keep the railway running while we're doing that. So, for example, my control room staff will speak directly to the driver of the train to get a first account of what's happened. So you can imagine that's often quite a traumatic first account. So that's another group of individuals that we need to take care of. There are CCTV operators who, part of our assessment process, are tasked with viewing the CCTV, which is a particularly difficult task. And of course, they are affected by it. We have a system which we call TRIM, which is, I think it's Trauma Risk Intervention Program, something like that. It's drawn from the military. And it's a scheme by which we have officers, buddy officers trained across the force who make an initial intervention with people who've been involved in such incidents. And from that, we can make referrals onto professional services as required. We currently make the first intervention to around 300 members of staff a month, such is the range and the impact of this sort of activity. Clearly, we do that in Scotland as well. That will clearly be one of the areas of operational practice that we'll be sharing with colleagues, because it's a vital part of supporting the staff that do a really difficult job on a day-to-day basis.
So just to clarify, it will continue after the devolution of railway policing?
So it will certainly continue within BTP, and we'll share our experiences with Police Scotland. I'm pretty certain that they would want to do something similar.
Currently, within Police Scotland, similar to Mr. Crowther, we have TRIM process, and we also have our employee-assisted programme. You know, policing's not a very pleasant occupation, there's no doubt about that. We have road fatalities, we have sudden deaths of infant children, we have officers that their day is spent in darkened room viewing the most horrific offensive actions against children. So we have to have something in place to support them psychologically as well as emotionally. So currently Police Scotland, like BTP, has a very robust employee assistance programme and a TRIM process.
Okay, thank you.
Mary?
Thank you, Convener. Can I just ask, perhaps Mr. Crowther and Ms. Vitty would be the best people to answer the question. Was any model other than complete integration put forward for consideration? And is there another model that you think would work other than complete integration?
So, we've made a number of submissions to Scottish Government during the process of the discussions around this. As I said at the beginning, we completely get, understand and support the principle of devolution. There are different means of achieving that. I think we've given some professional advice about what those options might be, but we'll work with whatever option is taken forward, as you'd expect us to deliver that in the interests of the public. Perhaps I'll stop there.
Okay, thank you.
I would just add that throughout this process leading up to devolution date, it is really vital that we are able to articulate and communicate with the Scottish Police Authority and the Scottish and Police Scotland the risks, because it is a very complex process, and that shouldn't be seen as anything more than actually making sure that this is a success, because actually we have to be able to align our operations from that D-Day. So I think it's really key that we continue to do that.
Thank you.
Can I just ask one thing before I bring in Douglas then? Clearly, the railway operators are people that you have to work in partnership with. And delays, as I've already mentioned, and handling these to minimise them without compromising safety is paramount. Can I ask Mr Higgins, if there's an accident in the motorway of some kind, is there any cognizance taken on the effect of the delay and how to handle this as effectively as possible to ensure when the traffic is tailed back, then the impact economically is huge apart from the devastation of the accident itself. Now, that's something that's, if you like, in the DNA of British Transport Police in mitigating any delays, because otherwise the whole railway system is going to grind to a halt. Can you comment on that aspect?
Yeah, yes, Convener, acutely aware. The latest figure I held, was told, is that if a major road, the M8, M77, M90, is shut, then it costs the Scottish economy potentially £250,000 every 30 minutes. So my road policing officers deploy on the basis that they need to get the road open as soon as they possibly can. But if you've got a fatality involving six or seven different people over three cars, with two people still trapped, and actually having to cut them out and rescue them, then it's not quite as straightforward as you would like it to be. Often the delay in reopening the road isn't actually the investigation, it's actually clearing the road and repairing, for example, the crash barrier, because it's not safe to be driven on until the damage that's been caused to the infrastructure of the road is repaired. So all these factors combine to make a fatal road accident. Invariably, the road will be closed longer than it would if it occurred on the railway line. But the short answer is yes, we are acutely aware of the economic impact, but we also have a duty to ensure that the cause of the accident, to give the family of the deceased some assurance that it's been properly investigated and reported to the Procurator Fiscal.
Okay, thank you. Douglas.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Could I first of all ask ECC Higgins and Mr Foley, you've made it very clear during this morning's session that you are only looking ahead based on Parliament's decision, whatever that is, and you've looked at how you would mitigate some of the concerns that have been highlighted. But can I ask, since you're taking an impartial view on this, have you identified any risks, any potential pitfalls in merging BTP into Police Scotland? Any at all?
Yes. Of course, Mr. Crowther's alluded to it as well.
Sorry, I was asking for Police Scotland's.
Yes, I'm going to answer you, Mr. Ross. What I was going to say is that Mr. Crowther has alluded to the fact that there's a massive turnover of staff in British Transport Police, and there is a risk that on transfer, that skill base will be diluted. It's my job to make sure that doesn't happen. There is a risk that the terms and conditions might be diluted, but again, I think we've made it clear that we are hoping Scottish Government will address that. There is a risk in terms of the financial side to ensure that Police Scotland is properly compensated for taking on this additional responsibility. So these are all risks that we recognise, but a lot of it will be dependent on what the legislation says, excuse me, and what happens post the debate in Parliament.
If I could respond as well, Mr. Ross, in relation to the potential of a financial risk, I have officers going down to work closely with BTPA officers on Friday to look over the cost allocation model, so we'll have greater transparency after that, but clearly there is a risk there, but we don't believe it's significant, but we'll have to look into it further.
And these are all risks you've fed into the Scottish Government as well. You're saying that you agree with these risks and you've fed that into the Scottish Government.
There is a programme board which I referred to earlier, Mr. Ross, and yes, these risks are discussed in detail on that board, and actions are taken to mitigate against risks, whether that be to, for example, SPA or Police Scotland, or BTP or BTPA. So we work together and collectively, not only with Scottish Government, but with the Westminster Government as well.
So maybe to stick with Mr. Foley and a potential risk, an independent evaluation of Police Scotland and Police and Fire Reform stated that Police Scotland representatives saw themselves in a consolidating and integrating phase, and that the real transformation of the service delivery is yet to come. It then went on to say that the challenges associated with transformation phase are seen as being at least as significant as those already encountered in integrating the services. Given that analysis which has been done, given the uncertainties that still remain, is now the right time to be bringing on board another element to Police Scotland? Is now the correct time for BTP to be integrated with Police Scotland?
Well, as we discussed earlier, we're talking about a period that is 2 years away from integration. And my belief is that we can achieve that if that is the task that Parliament sets us within that time frame. From an operational point of view, again, Mr. Ross, it would be inappropriate for me to comment. I'm not a police officer, so if you don't mind, perhaps that part of the question could be answered by Mr. Higgins or Mr. Crowther.
I agree with Mr. Foley in this. 2 years, frankly, is a luxury based on what we've had to do previously in terms of bringing together Police Scotland. So I'm confident that the transition would occur, and it would occur in collaboration and partnership with British Transport Police.
Can I ask Mr. Higgins, you say in your evidence that following integration, in the short to medium term, it is the intention of Police Scotland to retain the current specialist skills and knowledge built up by BTP officers. What's the long-term intention?
Well, the long-term intention, Mr. Ross, is what I talked about, is that training for policing in the railway network will form part of the initial training for all officers that join Police Scotland. So rather than having a small number of officers with specialist skills, we will have 17,000 officers with the ability to operate within the railway environment, and within that, a number of small officers, a smaller group of officers with the specialist skills in terms of rail investigation, rail death, etc., etc.
So based on that answer and that written submission that I've just read out, are you saying in the long term there will not be the current specialist skills and knowledge available to Police Scotland that's currently available from the British Transport Police?
No, I haven't said that at all. I have no idea why you're even asking me that question.
Well, if I could maybe explain then, if that's okay.
Please.
Because you make it quite clear in here that this is the short to medium term, and that you will retain the current specialist skills and knowledge built up by BTP officers, yet you go on to say in the long term it will be an additional training of all officers for 2 to 3 weeks during their course at Tully Allen. Are you honestly saying that officers coming into Police Scotland with an additional 2 to 3 weeks training will have the same expertise and specialist skills and knowledge built up by current BTP officers?
What I'm saying, Mr. Ross, quite clearly, is that I'm mainstreaming the training that BTP officers in Scotland currently receive, and I'm quite sure that within the BTP specialism, we will have investigative officers who are specifically trained, like, for example, my crash investigators who go to fatal road accidents to deal with fatalities on the rail network, as well as having the general 2 to 3 weeks training, which will allow a greater number of officers to operate in the rail network. We will invest to ensure that the current level of skill available to investigate such things as fatal rail accidents will continue.
And what level of investment will that be?
Well, we would need to look to see what the demand is and make sure that we have so for example, I have something like 600 road police officers that police the road networks. Not every one of those 600 police officers, 600 road policing officers, is a crash investigator, but we have enough crash investigators to investigate the number of fatal road accidents in Scotland's roads. So similarly, we will have a number of officers that are able to work in the rail network the way my road policing officers work in the road network. And within that team, we will have a number of bespoke officers that can take on the specialist investigations, similar to the crash investigators that do the fatal road accidents currently.
Chief Constable Crowther, can I ask you about the Police Scotland 2026 consultation document? And I'm just using this as an example. It, not within the document, but following the document's release, it was established that up to 400 police officers in Scotland could be lost. And some of that work and some of their replacement will be from people who don't want to join Police Scotland. They have specialisms in terms of IT, etc., but they don't want to be a Police Scotland officer. Do you currently, and I presume you do, the majority of your officers don't want to be police officers, they want to have a specialism within the transport police? And do you think there is a danger that people who have that interest, who want to join a transport police force, will not be encouraged to join a Police Scotland that's only giving them a couple of extra weeks training as part of a general training programme to become police constables? And maybe we can come back to Mr Higgins, because I see he's shaking his head once you've spoken.
I'm not sure I'm qualified to speak about what the future might hold in terms of the plan that Police Scotland have. I think Mr Higgins has and will answer that. What I know about the current people in BTP is that they joined BTP. They could have joined a geographic force, and they didn't, and they're very proud to be transport police officers. If they transfer, they will continue to be proud transport police officers and deliver a great service. I guess one of the interesting challenges for me, and indeed to share with Police Scotland, is in the transitionary period. So what we don't yet know is what the impact might be of people joining in the intervening period. With the prospect of transfer into Police Scotland. That may not be a problem, or it may be a disincentive. We simply don't know. And so we will need to work that through, and I think in our evidence we highlighted that there may well be a case for us to discuss at some stage with Police Scotland if there were gaps that began to appear, which could come about either through some challenges in recruiting, or indeed some existing BTP officers may seek to transfer to the England and Wales element of BTP. And we'd need to fill gaps. I've still got to deliver policing until such time as it's not my responsibility. And there could become some circumstances where we might need a conversation to say, are there some secondees that come to us under my direction and control during that period? So I think this is an area that we don't yet know how it will play out. It's something we've identified, something that we have to jointly plan for as we go forward.
To come in with supplementaries, but just to be clear, is it Police Scotland's intention to have a dedicated transport police unit within Police Scotland? And would then the option of people from British Transport Police to join that unit be available? And is there a guarantee that they would not be deployed anywhere else? Just now they work for British Transport Police, they're on the railway, they've got the expertise. If there was such a unit, would there be a guarantee that because of pressures of numbers in a certain area in Police Scotland, they wouldn't be taken away from that work and deployed somewhere else?
I'll certainly answer that, Convener, and perhaps address your points as well, Mr Ross. As I said earlier in my evidence, I have given assurance that any a member of British Transport Police that transfers into Police Scotland, their right to police the railway environment until they retire will be respected. They will not be moved unless they volunteer to go elsewhere. On an ad hoc basis, will they be removed out of the station to go and police the community beat in Cathcart? No. Heaven forbid we have a major incident, would they be deployed to support the policing of that major incident? Potentially. Yes. Is there intention to have a bespoke transport unit within Police Scotland? Absolutely. We see it very much sitting alongside a road policing unit, two separate entities, but sitting within that overarching command. And in terms of moving forward, we would train every officer, give them the 2 to 3 weeks training which all BTP officers in Scotland currently get in addition to their 11 weeks.
I think that's muddying the waters a little bit. While that's a good thing to do, then it doesn't begin to meet the expertise of the actual trained unit. Mm-hmm. Now, you've said anyone transferring, the intention would be not to deploy them. If new members join the specialist unit that are already in the Police Scotland, would they be deployed routinely if there was the need?
I'm sorry, I don't follow. New members of...
Is there a distinction between the people, the 284 officers that I believe
are currently employed
in Policing Scotland under British Transport Police?
So,
I understand you to say till they choose to retire from that unit, they would not be deployed. What if other officers joined the unit that were from Police Scotland? Would they be expected to be deployed if it was deemed necessary?
No, because they would be treated no different, for example, than the road policing unit. They would be a bespoke specialist unit dedicated to policing the rail network, and we also would have to maintain the service level agreement that we have with the rail providers. What I'm saying is that we will train every officer, every new recruit, to have an awareness and ability to operate within the rail environment, but we will maintain a specialist unit of the 284 officers, or what we determine with the service providers, what the appropriate level is. And within that unit, they will receive the additional specialist training to allow them to carry out crash investigations. I think there's a very strong and clear parallel with how a road policing unit currently operates in policing the road network.
That's helpful. Now, there's a number of supplementaries. John, do you still have a supplementary? Yes.
Thank you, Convener. And it is around the issue of training, Mr. Higgins. And I accept individuals' knowledge is time-limited, but it certainly was the case that British Transport officers undertook exactly the same training as Geographic Force officers. When you talk about this additional training, is that the same training? And at the moment, as I understand, having completed their time at Tully Island, British Transport officers then go off to do this in 2 or 3 weeks. Are you talking about exactly the same 2 or 3 weeks? And is that why you refer to seeking the assistance of BTP in the provision of that training?
Yes, currently, Mr. Finney, all officers, BTP and Police Scotland, complete the 11-week initial training course at the Police College Tully Allen. Thereafter, Police Scotland officers go to their divisions, and the British Transport Police officers have this additional 3 weeks training. That's the 3 weeks that we want to replicate at the Scottish Police College, so we will rely heavily on the assistance of BTP to develop that course and just look to see how we can deliver that.
So accepting that we have this cohort of officers presently who are British Transport officers who you've given an undertaking to maintain within the policing and the railway policing environment, there will be retirals, there will be people who will leave whatever race. That's no different. Arguably, you're supplementing that diminishing resource with additional resource.
Yeah, we have to look ahead. I mean, 284 officers can get swallowed up very, very quickly in terms of retirals and transfers elsewhere. So we have to plan to, you know, as Mr. Crowther alluded to, the high level of turnover. And that's not unique to British Transport. Any small unit of that number, there is always a high level of turnover. So you have to plan for that reduction and make sure that you have appropriately trained and equipped officers able to step in and fill those gaps and take up that role.
And finally, if I may, on the issue of deployment, both for Police Scotland officers and British Transport Police officers, there are officers who perhaps from constituent forces were not enthusiastic about the movement to a single police service in Scotland, who have subsequently moved literally from one end of the country to other as a career development through choice.
Yes.
That's the case, is it?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Okay, and then Ben, followed by Stuart and Fulton.
Thank you, Convener. It's just coming on the back of some of the points that were made earlier. I noticed in the BTP evidence that there was a commitment to work constructively, and that is hugely welcome, should the will of Parliament be to proceed with this devolution and implementation. And also your statements earlier, Charlotte Vitty, about wanting to highlight risks in good faith in order to address those risks, and Mr. Higgins spoke about the risks as well. I just wondered if you could elaborate perhaps more on what high-level discussions are going on, what procedures are being put in place, what mechanisms are being taken forward in order to address some of the risks that were highlighted by both of you, either in your written evidence or in the evidence session here today.
The main areas of work at the moment are within the joint programme board, and then the individual work streams that there are seven of underneath that. And within our business, we have mirrored that exact structure to make sure that we are really driving out these areas in order to make sure that we're communicating effectively with that programme board. And we've mirrored it in terms of resource from the authority and also resource from within the force. So actually we're capturing both the governance and authority requirements and also the operational elements of the business. We then bring that back to the programme board and share that with our colleagues around the table.
If I could perhaps respond as well, Mr. McPherson. The programme board is made up of representatives from the SPA, BTPA, Scottish Government, and the Westminster Government. BTP and Police Scotland have now recently joined that process. The reason for not being involved earlier was just because a lot of it was concentrated around the legislation and what might be required, so there was a heavy civil service involvement in that. As Charlotte has mentioned, there are seven work streams, and the work streams are shared almost, you might want to describe it as that. So SPA and BTPA will be involved in some, and there's a bit of a mix over there. There's a risk register which is set up. The meetings are regular. The next one is towards the end of this month. They are well attended. I'm on the programme board, as is Charlotte, and we have senior representation, so we're managing the process effectively to a timeline.
For us to make it clear that, and for our business, the risks, some of the emerging risks actually are happening to us right here and now. We have to change our way that we are working and negotiating some of our commercial contracts, because obviously there's no point in signing a 5-year national contract for IT service delivery. We have to make sure that we are agile to be able to deal with a devolution date. So the risks emerging are about us communicating effectively with the Scottish Police Authority, but also about to manage our own business with the pressures that we are currently facing.
And throughout all those mechanisms and those discussions, is the same sense of good faith and constructive, collaborative spirit and determination throughout all the discussions? Is that something that's shared absolutely paramountly by all sides?
Yeah, it's an open forum, so you know, we're able to share our views amongst each other and identify areas where we think we need to do work to perhaps overcome potential difficulties. It's well project managed, as you would expect to see under those circumstances.
Yeah, we have a specialist resource to work through and support us in this process, and I think it's no one's best interest to not come to the table together, that's absolutely what we're doing.
Absolutely, thank you for that reassurance.
Close off on it, Mr. McPherson. It's became apparent, just to give you a sense of where we are with it, the momentum has picked up quite a bit of pace in my view over the last couple of months. Certainly I have officers attached to this, and the feedback from them is that the collaboration and cooperation that they have with colleagues across that group has increased significantly. So that would suggest that there is a sense of momentum as we move forward.
So a positive effect.
A positive, yes.
Thank you.
Stuart, followed by Fulton.
Mr. Ross raised the risks associated with a putative loss of 400 officers in Scotland over the next few years. I wonder, Mr. Crowther, in relation to the 28,400 police who have been lost since 2013 in England and Wales, whether that has translated into any risks and difficulties for British Transport Police.
Well, I think I'd draw two points from that, if I may. The number of resources that have been lost to policing in England and Wales has primarily fallen to geographic forces.
Yep.
And we saw an HMIC report last week that spoke of many of the difficulties that are being found within police forces. There are clear arguments and viewpoints around whether or not the two are connected, of course. In respect of BTP, actually we've encountered a different experience. So, as you know, the train operating community directly fund their budget. So the police authority independently sets the budget and then it's levied according to a charging model to the industry. And those are PSAs, police service agreements. We enjoy around £20 million of extra funding, enhanced police service agreements, which those fairly hard-nosed commercial people decide to fund in addition to what we already do because of the value of they see in what we deliver. In many respects, and I had this conversation with Her Majesty's Inspectorate, who are currently inspecting us, the graph that shows the financial profile for many geographic forces in England and Wales tends to go downwards, whereas ours has gone upwards, which I think is an interesting commentary on the service that people believe that they get from British Transport Police.
Can I, since you've raised it and I hadn't been aware of this, the 20 million enhanced payments, what's that actually buying, as briefly as possible, because shall we are now?
So it can buy a range of different facilities. So some police service agreement holders buy in specific neighbourhood teams in some areas that they want to enhance what we do. It might be police community support officers, which of course we have in England and Wales, not in Scotland, or officers. In other circumstances, we've been doing a lot of work with Network Rail to identify how we can contribute to their effective running of the network. So I seconded one of my best chief superintendents for a year into Network Rail to help them develop a national disruption strategy. And a net result of that is around £8 million of additional investment from Network Rail into BTP and infrastructure that we work very closely with Network Rail to avoid disruption. Elsewhere, in places like Transport for London, for example, as part of our wider public value ethos. So we believe that a safe and secure, so low crime, high confidence network is a good thing, but also a reliable network is a good thing because it's about the economy, social inclusion. So with Transport for London, we've got some interesting initiatives where they fund us additionally, but we've got response police officers who are trained as medics. And so whilst they're out there answering normal calls, London Underground has a particular challenge with people taken ill on trains during the rush hour. And if you get a tube train held up, trains back up in the tunnels and you create a critical incident behind it. So we deploy police officers with medical training who are able to take command of an incident and actually get people off trains to allow that to be running and give immediate first aid before the ambulance service arrive. Or indeed, we jointly crew effectively a joint incident resolution team of engineers and response people from the railway so that they turn up together, they get the advantage of the blue light route to a scene, and then you have all the people who can solve an incident quickly on scene together, working very closely together. So many of these are steeped in a very clear financial case for keeping the network running.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Foley.
Yeah, I'm just wondering if I can get a view from Police Scotland in terms of how the recruitment for the new, well, we'll call it a transport unit, would work. Would there be an opportunity for individuals to state a preference and to bend that at the point of entry into the police, or would it be more that, you know, while they're within the police, that would be an area they would choose to specialise in and be supported and trained in to do so?
I think it would be a combination of both, Mr McGregor. I mean, firstly, in terms of how we would maintain the figures within the transport unit, any future applicant to Police Scotland will be very well aware during the application process that they could very well find themselves posted to the transport unit. Currently, any new recruit coming into Police Scotland is asked to nominate three preferenced areas where they would wish to work. I haven't really thought it through. Normally, it's geographical areas, so they would like to work in the Glasgow area, the Lanarkshire area, the Ayrshire area. I haven't actually thought through whether or not we would include the opportunity straight off the bat for them to go into the transport hub. It's a fair suggestion, but what I am absolutely certain of, similarly for when we're recruiting for road policing, if we just keep in that parallel, we invite people to apply to undertake duties within road policing, and then once they're successful, we'll give them bespoke training like advanced driver training and crash investigation. And I see a similar path into the transport unit. Equally so, potentially it might be a preference at the initial point of application. So, you know, new recruits can say their first preference is to work in Glasgow, but actually they would quite like to work in Glasgow within the transport unit as well. I don't see any huge difficulty with that.
Can I just finish with one last cross-border issue, and that's the issue of tasers. September 2006, BTP announced it taking the decision to deploy taser devices to some of its officers in Scotland. I think taser devices give officers extra level of protection to protect themselves from the and the public when faced with extreme violence, and every force in England and Wales, including BT, routinely deploy these. Now, there's a policy within Police Scotland only to permit authorised farms officers to deploy tasers. Could you perhaps comment on how this would play out?
From a Police Scotland point of view, Convener, you're absolutely correct. Currently, it's only my authorised firearms officers that carry a taser. Should integration occur, then one of the first things that I will have to do is assess the threat within within the wider rail network and see whether it's still appropriate in terms of the wider Police Scotland threat assessment. We would continue that practice. Yeah.
So potentially there could be a different policy deployed north of the border from south of the border. I think then the immediate question is, does that make, if there's tasers on one side of the border not deployed by the British the transport police in the other one, does that make it more vulnerable?
No, I would take a slightly different perspective. What I would say is it would be a consistent policy for all Police Scotland officers. And it would be about the availability of tasers within the rail network, which could be delivered by the existing firearms officers. And that's not to say that when we carry out the threat assessment, actually we agree that it's still appropriate to continue the carriage of tasers within rail stations.
So perhaps someone who was a deployed firearms officer would be seconded or would be a permanent member of the... I'm not quite sure how this would work exactly. Am I seeing problems where none exist?
Well, I think the fundamental question would be, come April 19, if that's the decision, it wouldn't be, you know, there's tasers in stations in England and Wales and there's not tasers in Scotland. It would be, what is Police Scotland's capability to meet every threat in every environment, whether that be in Sockey Hall Street or Union Street or within Central Station or Waverley Station. It would be, what's the best way to mitigate threat? Now, the best way to mitigate threat is potentially to continue to have a taser deployment within train stations, but currently Police Scotland only issues tasers to authorised firearms officers, and the British Transport Police, my understanding is that they are taser-trained officers, but they are not firearms officers.
Mr. Crowther?
Yes, Mr. Higgins is right. So the people who carry taser within British Transport Police are not exclusively firearms officers. Clearly we've got firearms officers and they carry taser as well. I think, and as Mr. Higgins said, that, you know, they'll may need to make their assessments of the threat and risk. Our approach is based on a transport-specific strategic threat and risk assessment of terrorist threats. We seek to counter 24 identified attack methodologies, and we deploy resources capability according to those attack methodologies that we think are pertinent to the rail sector, the transport sector. I won't give you the full history lesson, but the Britain's railways have been attacked by terrorists for three centuries. Mm-hmm. And we know that internationally, transport hubs and the transport network are an attractive target to terrorists because of the economic impact, and they are crowded places. And so that is what drives our deployment. As responsibility passes, clearly the responsibility for making that assessment passes, and I'm sure Mr. Higgins will make appropriate judgments.
Okay. Supplementaries, and they would need to be very, very short. John and then Douglas.
It's just to say to both the operational police officers, a risk assessment is an ongoing process. Now, clearly, an idealist like me wants a situation where in 2019 not only are the tasers back locked in the cupboard, but the guns are back too. Perhaps unlikely, but it really is entirely academic to be discussing a threat level in 2 years hence. Would you agree?
Short answer is yes, Mr. Finney. Yep.
Thank you, Convener. While I understand Mr. Finney's argument, I think we should always look at all the eventualities and possibilities. And would it be a concern for BTP if Scotland decided not to have tasers, officers routinely deployed with tasers in stations in Scotland, yet they were south of the border, would there be a concern that there could be a higher risk of a terrorist attack taking place or starting north of the border than south of the border?
I'm not sure I'd make that link. I think we would work really closely with Police Scotland to understand what the nature of the risk was, and come to appropriate decisions about how that would be dealt with. I think there was an interesting element. It goes to the earlier point around cross-border operations and what happens to officers from either force who transcend into the other jurisdiction carrying taser or indeed firearms. You know, when you look at some of the attack methodologies deployed elsewhere, there are all sorts of tactics that have to be deployed. And one of the key things we must sort out is what that interoperability looks like and how it's best managed.
And thing that's been raised and it will be considered, it's now very much in the forefront to be considered.
Very quickly, of Mr. Higgins ask, will the determination of BTP south of the border play into any thought process Police Scotland would take? Would they be a consultee if police BTP still believe it's a threat that they require officers to be armed with tasers south of the border? Will that come into your or your successor's consideration?
Yes, it will come into the assessment, Mr. Ross, absolutely. Yeah.
Just the final question. Can I ask BTP if it's received a response to its request for urgent clarification on future cross-border policing arrangements?
I've received an assurance from the Department for Transport that it will be dealt with within the legislative arrangements.
So not yet, but you hope it's imminent?
I'm assured that we've dealt with. I'm keen to see the legislative draft when it comes forward.
Okay. Thank you very much. That concludes our line of questioning. What's been a very helpful session. We now move into private session. Next committee meeting will be on 14th of March, when we'll hear from the Minister of Community Safety and Legal Affairs on the Limitation Childhood Abuse Bill, and continue to take evidence on the Railway Policing Bill. I suspend briefly to allow witnesses to leave and the public gallery to clear.